scripture you're gonna take one from Revelation 7. 9-7. After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number of all nations, and kindred, and people, and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, and palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, Salvation unto God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood around and about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshipped God, saying, Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, What are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell amongst them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sunlight on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto the living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away their sins from their eyes. End of scripture.
Thanks be to God. Let us all stand for the reading of the gospel, which will be done by daughter Mrs. Cheryl Brong. Let us all stand for the reading of the gospel.
The gospel is taken from John chapter 14, reading from verses 1 to 6 and verses 27. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. There where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Verse 27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Prayer and scripture.
Praise to Christ, O Lord.
We now have a special song, Does Jesus Care? And this will be done by Fionn.
It's a special request. This song is not just Does Jesus Care, but Tempted and Tried, Father Along. Special request by his son Wendy Lantini. Tempted and tried, we the day long. while there are us living among us, we understand all by and by. Father, that heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new. That day gone is a curse from which I stumble and fail. Evil is into eternal hell. No more night, and no more pain. There'll be no more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I Am. And we will live in the light of God's risen all around. All the nations bow down to see. The only sound is the praises to Christ, our King. And slowly the names from the book are read. And I know the King, I know the King. There's no need to dread. And no more night, there'll be no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I Am. And we will live in light of the risen land. I see over there, there's a mansion prepared just for me and just for you, where we will live with our Savior eternally. ever crying again and praises to the great I am. And we will live in light of the risen. Let go and praises to and praise to the great. The light of the risen, the risen.
Amen. Amen. No more. No more tears. I'll now ask to stand as a congregation. We'll sing just before we have Reverend Davis coming to minister to us. We'll have that hymn, Blessed Assurance. And we'll sing The Glory of God.
This is my story. This is my song praising my Savior all the day long. Just before I turn your attention to the text for our reflection today, let me also express publicly condolences to the family of Brother Philip. I too would have been very surprised when I learned of his passing, having not too long ago seen him, interacted with him, and really it just reminds us that we really never know the minute nor the hour. And so we should always be ready. For the past 2 weeks, I have been reflecting on John chapter 14. And it does seem to me that we just seem to be having so many more and more deaths. And so I want to continue reflecting on John chapter 14, particularly today, highlighting verse 5, where Thomas said to Jesus, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" In case you forgot, this occurs in the context of Jesus saying, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places, mansions. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you will be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going." And then Thomas says, "We do not know the way. We do not know where you're going, neither do we know the way." Let us pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, continue to speak to us. And may we hear, and may our lives be transformed by your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think you might be aware, John chapter 14 occurs in anticipation of Jesus' departure. So there is something of a death kind of a story here. And as they anticipated Jesus leaving, in fact, he had already warned them that he will die. And remember, Peter took real umbrage to that and said, "You can't talk like that." And Jesus said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." And so naturally, people mourn when they lose those they love. Naturally, people mourn differently naturally. Some may cry, some may not. Some may get busy so that they are distracted, and some may want to be by themselves, and many would advise that that isn't often the best method. But people deal with death and loss differently. But what I think is consistent is that when we lose those we love, it does cause some internal trouble. So we could understand why Jesus would have said to the disciples who anticipated his departure, "Let not your hearts be troubled." He reassures them that don't worry, that essentially everything will be all right. And what strikes me naturally, perhaps by now you realize from this text, is Thomas's response. Thomas says, "Lord, we do not know where you're going, so how could we know the way?" So there are two issues Thomas raises here. One of them is destination, where you're going. And one of them is route, the way to where you're going. I doubt anyone would dispute that there is clear indication as to the destination question. Jesus was not just leaving for a vacation. Jesus was not just taking a break. He was not just going away on a trip or a far away journey. Jesus was clear that his destination was what we simply call was heaven. He was clear that his destination was heaven. And in this text, Jesus gives us a deep sense and appreciation that there is more to life and living than what we experience in this space, in this place, and at this time. So he challenges his disciples to understand that there is a here and now, but there is some place different from here and now. And so he was going to prepare, he says, for them. Interestingly enough, he says, in my Father's house. So the language here is not just heaven, but it is being, as it were, in the house of my Father. Or to use the text further, he's saying, I go so that where I am with the Father, there you will be also. So heaven is not just a place. Heaven is really about being with the Father. And so Jesus is clear here that his purpose for coming to earth and his work and ministry amongst us was so that we could be with the Father, be in heaven. Now, just a quick question and answer before I move on. When I read, in my Father's house there are many dwelling places, the question did surface in my mind, what is the capacity of heaven? Since Jesus is saying, he came so that we could get to heaven, we could be in our Father's house, what is the capacity of heaven? Well, you may know that there are some persons, sadly misinformed, who misrepresent Revelation chapter 7 and seem to suggest that heaven can only accommodate 144,000. Well, if that were the case, well, we done doomed. We can't get there none tall. But Jesus here says, in my Father's house there are many dwelling places. And it is as if he's saying, there is a space for me and there is a space for you. John 3:16 makes this point differently when it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever. It is as if the text gives us a clear sense that you don't have to worry about space in heaven because Jesus came to take us there. And if everybody responds, God has a space there for you. Isn't that why Peter records it in saying, don't think that God is slack in his promise because you've been wondering how long they say Jesus will come again. He says, no, he's not slack. He said, he's giving you time because his desire is that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So if you ever had a doubt, heaven would always have enough space to accommodate you. If you ever had a doubt, heaven will never be so rampant that God says there is no more space for you. The problem with heaven is not the space or the capacity, but really is about us and whether or not we are able and willing to make use of what is there. Now, this is what caught my attention, going back to Mr. Thomas. Thomas said, we don't know where you're going, and we don't know the way. Now, I was really troubled by this. Thomas did not know where Jesus was going, which means Thomas really did not know where Jesus came from. Because if he knew where Jesus came from, as Paul in Philippians 2, then it should have given him a sense of where Jesus was returning to. I'm thinking, So if Thomas didn't know where Jesus came from, nor where Jesus was going to, then Thomas had no idea where Jesus was seeking to take him. Because if Thomas did not know where Jesus came from and where Jesus was going to, then it seems reasonable to conclude that Thomas didn't know where Jesus was planning to take them. Now I am troubled, which made me wonder further. Did Thomas even know where he wanted to go? Because think of it. If Thomas did not know where Jesus came from and where Jesus was going to and where Jesus was intended to take them, then you have to ask yourself, did Thomas himself even have a sense of where he wanted to go? Because the way I see it is that if George is going to Tongue, and I want to go to Tongue, but Paul is going Chateau, I am going with Paul, I will go with George, because I know where I'm going. I want to go to Tongue. So you have to ask yourself, why was Thomas with Jesus if Jesus was clear about his purpose and mission, but Thomas had no sense of where Jesus was going to? Now you see, Jesus was clear. Jesus' mission was unambiguous. Jesus came to earth and his purpose and goal was to take us to be with the Father. There was no ambiguity about that. There was no doubt that in Jesus' mind, his clear purpose was so that you and I and all of us will be again with our Father in heaven. If you don't know that, let me tell you it again. That there is a single purpose for why Jesus came to this earth. And he captured that severally. Jesus came to earth so that you and me could be one again with the Father. Paul puts it this way. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. John 3:16 captures it. That whosoever believes should not go to hell, perish, but be everlasting with God. Jesus says, I came to seek and to save the lost. But that now raises other questions. Thomas causes me to ask and consider, what was Thomas's ultimate life goal? In other words, what was he living for? Why was he with Jesus? What was he hoping to achieve and accomplish? What was Thomas's ultimate goal in life? In other words, apart from everything else, what is the one thing Thomas wanted to ensure he accomplished and achieved? Now, again, let me tell you, I have no doubt that Jesus was clear about what his single purpose was. Don't get mixed up with this thing, you know. Sometimes people see Jesus going about healing. Jesus' purpose was not healing. Sometimes people see Jesus going about teaching. His ultimate goal was not teaching and education. Sometimes people saw Jesus going about feeding. His main life goal and purpose wasn't to make sure you had food. In fact, John's gospel captures it. John says, the reason I'm telling you these stories about Jesus is so that you will come to believe. He says, Jesus did many other signs and so forth. And he understood that the reason Jesus healed the sick, the reason Jesus fed the hungry, the reason Jesus taught was so that we could be saved and at one with God. There was no doubt about that. Jesus didn't just want us to have physical health. That's why he says, what does it profit a person if they should gain the whole world and lose their soul? Let me tell you, you pray for COVID to pass. You pray for sick to be healed. You pray for finances to be recovered. Yes, God answers all those prayers. But God's primary concern is your eternal salvation. Are you with me? No, but what is your goal in life? It is obvious what Jesus came for, and Jesus' entire life and ministry was about how he could get us back to God. But yet, Thomas says, oh, we ain't know where we're going. We don't know where you're going, so which means we ain't know where we're going. And we don't know the way. Was Thomas's primary goal simply to be with Jesus? You know, some people liked the entertainment, to see Jesus healing people and crowds following Jesus, and Jesus take 5 loaves and 2 fish and feed 1,000. Wow! This man was a walking box office hit. Was that all he was interested in? Was Thomas just interested in military and political power? Because for many, when they thought of Jesus as the Messiah, they were thinking, here is someone who will give us power again. What was Thomas's ultimate life goal? And that makes me ask, what is your ultimate goal in life? Brother Philip, he has lived his life, and the question obtained for him, as it does for us, what is your ultimate goal in life, your ultimate, your primary, most important goal in life? What are you living for more than anything else? Maybe, for some people, their ultimate goal in life is to be happy. That is becoming more and more a mantra for people. All I want is to be happy. All I want you to be is happy. It is as if our emotional well-being is the most important thing in our life. Well, if that is your ultimate goal in life, I feel so sorry for you. Because there are a lot of people who will be happily going to hell. Hello, are you with me? If your ultimate goal in life is happiness, then, oh, you are in a sad state. Because joy and happiness in the flesh is so fleeting. And life is much more than what makes you feel good. And that's why some persons could live their whole life on drugs, because they just want a good feeling. What is your ultimate goal in life? There are people who have made terrible decisions and live with terrible decisions simply because it makes them feel good about themselves. Makes them feel happy. I remember one woman years ago telling me in one of our congregations, she was with this fellow and it was really a messed up story. He worked with her. And she knew that the guy was up to no good and all of that. But she said, Rev, he makes me feel so special. She said, we work at the same place and he is in the cubicle next to mine. But sometimes in the morning, when he comes to work and I'm at work, he will call me and ask, hey girl, how are you doing over there? Oh. Is that what we live for? What are you living for? What is your ultimate? The people who tell you their main goal and purpose in life is to make money, because they know once they make money, they're set for life. And they drive themselves, some honestly and some dishonestly, from day one to day ten, they are invested singularly, solely in trying to make another dollar, because somehow my goal in life is to possess things. Once I have a good house with a good security system and a nice car, and I could travel when I want, Sister Esther, and I could host people for parties and the like, I set for life. And maybe that's why Lotto calls it set for life, because there are some people, that's how they think. If I win money, big money, get big money, then I'm set for life. What are you living for, Thomas, is the question I'm asking. For some people, they're living to be good. They want to make sure they have a good name. that everybody likes them. Sisters, I've learned there's some people who are invested in a good name. They're so invested in a good name that they're duplicitous and they can't ever stand for anything because they're trying to make you like them and you like them and you like them, so they never really stand for anything. They will leave this world, and in your eulogy, you could say, they never had a quarrel with anyone. They were the best human being to have ever lived because everybody liked them. Hello? Is that what you are living for? So that people will love you? That you'll have a good name? There are some people who what they live for, they live for, hear this, they live to be loved and they live to love others. Now that sounds good and noble. But is that what we live for? Let me just put it into perspective for you. The Bible is clear. Our first love is not supposed to be people. Our first love is supposed to be God. And there, yes, there are people who love others to death, as they will tell you. And they live to make others happy. They live loving. Is that what you are living for? What are you living for? When your life is over and your eulogy is read, what will be your single most important accomplishment? That if anybody has to say anything about George, Paul, Mary, Philip, whatever is your name, that the one thing they must never miss is that every day of my life, I invested it. I worked tirelessly because my goal was to be eternally with my Father. That's what Jesus meant when he says it will profit you nothing if you could gain the whole world at the expense of your relationship eternally with your Father. What are you living for? What are you living for? What was Brother Philip living for? If he only lived for his children, he didn't do it right. If he only lived for his community, he didn't live it right. If he only lived to be happy, he didn't do it right. If he only lived for his family, he didn't do it right. If he only lived for his country, he didn't do it right. Are you hearing me? That the way that we are expected to live this life in this world is first and foremost That's why Jesus says, I go so that where I am, there you will be also. How could Thomas not get it? How could Thomas have been with Jesus and miss his ultimate purpose, you know? How could he? Because let me tell you, brothers and sisters, life and living is more than the 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years you live on this earth. Life and living and purpose in living must be more than what you can achieve here on earth. But whether you like it or not, everything you achieve down here, you know the statement, and that is true. Only what you do for Christ, in Christ, surrender to Christ, will last. What are you living for? What are you living for? My prayer, my hope, in this bright midday sun, on the 6th of March, 2021, that for each of us, we will be clear and single-minded. The most important goal in my life is to be in my Father's house eternally with Him. Anything else is a loss and a waste. I pray that as Jesus came to prepare for you and me, when we leave here, we will make use of what He has prepared for us. And we will hear our Father saying, "Well done." That's my prayer for Brother Philip and for all of us. And our Father will say, "Well done, Philip." He'll say, "Well done, whatever your name is. Well done, Adolf. Well done, Esther. Well done, Emil. Well done. Well done, Emily. Well done. Enter into my Father's house." That's when you have lived your life right. When eternally you and I can remain with the Father. Amen and amen. Let us pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we come to you today and we pray, dear God, that we will hear your word and surrender to your will. God, we remember Thomas saying, "God, Jesus, we don't know where you're going, we don't know the way." I pray, oh God, that we who are here, as we hear your word, that we will know where we ought to go, where we want to go, and know that the way is only through Jesus Christ. Because He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one returns to the Father except through Him. So continue to speak to us, O God, and may our hearts be humbled by your word, that we may surrender to your will. What are we living for? May it be, O God, that we are living only to be with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we stand and together share the words of the Apostles' Creed as we remind ourselves of some fundamental principles of our Christian faith? I believe in God, God Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and buried, descended into hell, the third day rose again from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sit at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, Holy Catholic Church, communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. We continue in prayer. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise today for our brother, whom we today lay to rest. We thank you, O God, for the joy and the blessing that his life has brought to others. We thank you for the many fond memories that many will have and celebrate of him. We thank you for the ways in which he touched lives, shaped lives, so that they will come to know you. We thank you for his words of encouragement, and when and where he encouraged to live for you. We thank you, O God, for the support and stability of a good father and grandfather and uncle, and examples, O God, that he has shared that are according to your will and word. We thank you, O God, for his service to his generation according to your will. And so we pray that now that death has come, that you will receive him into your perfect mercy and rest, that he has so lived that he will hear, "Well done, good and faithful." Not just good, but good and faithful servant. We pray for the family, O God, and pray that these times will provide them opportunities for their own reflection and to ask themselves about how they are living their own lives, and that in these seasons it will draw them even closer to you, and that for each member of the family, young or older, there will be no doubt, no ambiguity when the question, "What am I living for?" is asked. It must be no doubt in anyone's mind that they're living to be one again, eternally with the Father. This is our prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We continue with the commendation, and the Lord's Prayer will follow. Eternal God, you have made us all, and you hate nothing that you have made. In fact, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for redemption. And so, dear God, we commend our brother Philip Lorenzo Anthony into your perfect mercy and wisdom. Our desire and prayer, O God, is that eternal rest would be granted unto him and your light perpetual shine upon him. O Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the glory, ever and ever. Amen. "And Can It Be" is our hymn to close this part of the service. "And Can It Be That I Should Gain an Interest in the Savior's Blood? Died he for me who caused this pain, for me who him to death pursued."
to give you glory forever and always. Amen.
Driver! Come searching, and if you you know, find me. Find me, God. And if you don't hear from me, you'll come knocking at my door. Find me, God. You're not thinking of me. Oh, if you miss me, you'll come searching. And if you don't find me, I'll be gone. And if you don't hear from me, you'll come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in a twinkling of an eye. Oh, if you miss me, you'll come searching. And if you don't find me, I'll be gone. And if you don't hear from me, you'll come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in a twinkling of an eye. Oh, if you miss me, you'll come searching. And if you don't find me, I'll be gone. And if you don't hear from me, you'll come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in a twinkling of an eye. If you miss me, you'll come searching. And if you don't find me,
I love that song. Praise the Lord. My life's a song.